A reading from 2 Peter. This is now, beloved, the second letter I am writing to you. In them, I am trying to arouse your sincere intention by reminding you that you should remember the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the commandment of the Lord and Savior spoken through your apostles. First of all, you must understand this, that in the last days scoffers will come, scoffing and indulging their own lusts and saying, "Where is the promise of his coming? For ever since our ancestors died, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation." They deliberately ignore this fact that by the word of God, heavens existed long ago, and an earth was formed out of water and by means of water, through which the world of that time was deluged with water and perished. But by the same word, the present heavens and earth have been reserved for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the godless. But do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze and dissolved and the elements will melt with fire? But in accordance with his promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth, where righteousness is at home. Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace, without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord as salvation. The word of the Lord. Friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God, Trinity of love, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. This Lent, we are focusing in our worship, our preaching, on being people of God's promise, and kind of wondering together about what it means to live both out of God's promises as our foundation, and also to be living into them, to be living towards them. This passage that I just read brings an important word about God's promise. And actually, as I was flipping through the devotional that we have written by our members for Lent, within this week, there are about two people who chose this particular passage, and especially verse 9, to write their devotion about as they reflected on promise. And that verse talks about the fact that the Lord is not slow about his promise. It's what the passage is trying to remind us of, that God is not slow about God's promise. The promise that is particularly in view here, knowing that there are many promises given to us in Scripture, but this promise the author is talking about is the promise that Christ will come again and that there will be a new creation and that in that moment all evil will finally be completely destroyed. And the author tells us that he is writing kind of to counter what he calls scoffers, a word that we find throughout Scripture, those who deny the reliability of God and God's promise, who cast doubt on it. They say, "Where is this promise of his coming? Everything is just continuing on the way it's always been. We see no sign, no evidence that this coming is anything to be believed." And of course, scoffers are still with us today, those who do not believe or cast doubt on the reliability of God's promise. And if we're honest, at times those scoffers live within our own hearts as we search to find things to hold on to as we look for God's promise to come. And so the author reminds us, gives us this different perspective of God's time and God's view versus ours, right? 1,000 years are like a day in God's sight. The author tries to pull us back and give us this broader view of what God's promise is. And he urges us not to waver, but instead to cling to that promise with all that we have. And in order to help us do that, he points us backwards to the words of Scripture and the traditions and the words of the prophets that have been handed down to us, and also to what we have come to know about the very character of God, so that knowing and believing that God keeps God's promises, that God is reliable, that God is full of mercy, that knowing and believing that, we are able to then interpret what is happening, this delay in God's promise. We can interpret it in a different way when we hold on to what we know about who God is, how God works, and what God has done. And really, when the promise is fulfilled is not as important. It's less important. What matters is instead not when and how it comes. After all, as the scripture tells us, it will be like a thief in the night, coming as a surprise. But what matters instead is, first of all, trusting simply that it will come and come for us. And also then how that trusting shapes our lives in the present. That's really what the author is trying to help us do, to make that connection between believing the promise and living our lives. And he asks the question, since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be? So the promise is not just about someday. Our lives in every moment are meant to be lived in light of, in the context of these promises. The author points us to holiness and godliness, to being at peace as the way that we are to live in the meantime. Earlier in the book, he urges readers to make every effort to support your faith with goodness, and goodness with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with endurance, and endurance with godliness, and godliness with mutual affection, and mutual affection with love. And really what it comes down to is that if the traditions and the scripture, the words of the prophets, and the promises themselves, if they all reveal God to be two things, to be on the one hand pure righteousness, before whom no evil, no sin can stand, and yet at the same time to be so profoundly full of love and mercy and patience, even and especially towards sinners. If God is both of those things, and we are living in the promises of that God, then should we not be reflecting those same characteristics in our lives as we wait, as we live? The question becomes, how can we be people who strive for holiness, who struggle every day against the sin that binds us, who put it to death again and again and again, over and over within one day? And yet at the same time, how can we also be people who live with generosity and love and patience and mercy towards everyone around us? These two things are the witness that the world needs, that we are called to give about this God who has given us and called us into these promises. It's what it means to be people of the promise. Not just people who believe in an intellectual way the promises and count on it for our future security, but instead people whose choices and interactions every day are so marked by those promises and the claim that they have made on us that it becomes evident in the way we live. And so I think this text gives us a question to really dwell with this Lent. God's incredible promises of life and salvation and new creation are ours. They're ours in baptism. And so therefore, what sort of persons ought we to be? Amen.